want to hear from you. Follow us on Twitter, Facebook, or go to KCMXAM.com and go to the Talk to Us tab. Send us your thoughts. Lively conversations around news, politics, and people, plus local news and weather every 30 minutes.
She gets too hungry for dinner at 8. She likes the theater and never comes late. She never bothers.
Good morning, welcome back. 33 minutes after the hour, 8 o'clock. Hey, coming up at the quarter hour, I'm so excited. We're going to have Ernie Brace on the phone with us this morning. He and his wife have moved into the Klamath Falls area after retiring, but it was amazing. Not only was he a Korean War Marine pilot in the Korean War, he was shot down over there. Not only did he do that, but he was captured in 1965 and was released in 1973. He was the longest held civilian at the time ever in the Vietnam conflict. And we're going to be talking to him at the quarter hour break. But not only did he finish up with that, but when he got back, it took him a year to recover in the hospital down in San Diego. But he went back to work in China and Russia, and he was working on the Black Hawk program. He also, believe it or not, as a consultant, worked with the he was in Kuwait in March of 1991. So he was working with medevac and helicopter support for there. It's just amazing. On and on and on he goes. And Senator John McCain called him one of the most resilient individuals he has ever met in his entire life. And the fact that they were able to share a cell wall, they were not sharing the cell, but rather the wall in between. It's the Nat Geo prisoner of war video, and you can see it. It was released in April of 2013, but you can see it on YouTube, and Nat Geo's got, I think, the blog on there, but it's just amazing. And when you're talking about great Americans and the ability of hope and love of country and what it takes and the resiliency, it's amazing. And Senator John McCain said, an amazing survival story, and he said, Ernie Brace, one of the most resilient individuals he has ever encountered in his entire life. And at a low point in his captivity, Ernie Brace had spent 3.5 years in the jungle. He had landed his plane. He was flying supplies for the Department of Defense and the CIA, and he was flying supplies in as a civilian pilot. And when he landed at the airstrip, he was overtaken by North Vietnamese gunfire of the party in the plane. A couple of them were killed, and one escaped, and then he and another gentleman were taken prisoner. But they were out in the jungle, so they didn't have a prison like the Hanoi Hilton. And he was kept in a bamboo cage for over 3 years. He escaped a couple different times. And the first time he escaped, because he was tied. He was tied up inside the cage. And every night they would stretch him with his feet tied at one end and his hands bound and his head. They had a rope around his neck, and it went through the cage and tied to a pin outside, a large tent post, basically, outside of the cage. And that's the way he slept every night, on a couple of boards. And he realized that if he loosened the ropes and got his hands free, then he could get himself free. And he did. And finally, after a few months, he decided that he had to escape, and he did. And he was captured again. And this time they put barbed wire around the cage. And they put him in locks, like stocks. Like, they put his legs, his feet, his ankles in stocks with bolts. So they ran two large timbers through the cage with holes cut for his legs, with large metal bolts on the outside of the cage so he couldn't get to the bolts, with barbed wire wrapped around this bamboo cage. And he was able to, over course of time, fashion a wrench out of a piece of barbed wire. So even though he was being watched, he carefully he bent a piece of wire that would go around the bolt head and slowly unturn it. But he also knew that once he undid the bolts, there was no turning back, because he couldn't get the bolts back on and pretend like he was in the stocks. So when he did that, by this time, he couldn't walk. But he said, if I can just get out, that's what he'll do. Well, he crawled. He also got out of the barbed wire and out of the stocks and got loose again and crawled and didn't make it very far. Well, they beat him every time. So, of course, he was beaten again severely. This time, he was loaded up in a truck because he could not walk at all. And he was brought to the Hanoi Hilton, and he was put in a solitary confinement cell. It had not been occupied for a number of years. In fact, it turns out that John McCain was on the other side of that cell, and he had been there for a year and a half in solitary confinement. And when he heard noise from Ernie Brace, he started signaling him. Well, he was told not to communicate in the particular tap code that they worked on. And over the next course of a year, they communicated back and forth until they were caught. They were beaten severely and then separated. And then Ernie Brace stayed another few years, because he actually was there 7 years, 10 months, 7 days, the longest of a civilian capture in POW history in the Vietnam conflict for Americans. And he was released, of course, in March of 1973, and all this time had never met Commander John McCain at the time. But it's just an amazing story. He's written two books. In 1988, Ernie Brace wrote the book A Code to Keep, put out in 1988 by St. Martin's Press. And then just last year, he wrote a book called Monkey Paw Soup and Tales of Drugs, Thugs, Revolution, and War. And that book was put out in 2012. Well, he is going to be honored on Friday at Kingsley Field. He is a local Vietnam POW, and he'll be at Kingsley Field for the award presentation, and he will be awarded the Prisoner of War Medal and two Purple Hearts in the official ceremony at 2 p.m. at Kingsley Field, Klamath Falls. And, of course, the military department, the American military department, will be there. And was originally, turns out, Admiral James Stockdale was recommended Ernie Brace for those awards. And then they were represented to the Secretary of Navy in 2011. And, of course, with the help of Senator John McCain's office, and then drafted by this Captain Rod Knutson, a U.S. Navy retired. It's just an amazing story of what Americans can do if they put their mind to it. And with all the stories of American POWs in Vietnam and all the things that going through, you know, Ernie did what it took to stay alive and to cause as much havoc as he could with his fellow prisoners there in the Hanoi Hilton. And we'll be having him on in the next few minutes. Just so honored and privileged to have him on the phone. You know, if you think you're having a bad day, if you think you're ever having a bad day, you could always trade with former POW Ernie Brace. He's in his 80s and is sharp as a tack. Email, blogging on Google. Of course, he wrote a book, and it'll just be sensational to have him on. So come right back. And oh,
she gets too hungry to wait for dinner at 8. She loves the theater, but never comes late. She'd never bother with people she'd hate. That's why the lady is a tramp.
Stay tuned. Sunrise will return in a moment on KCMX News Time 880. A little bold and extremely fun, Monday through Friday, 6 to 9 a.m. on KCMX AM 880. Lively conversations around news, politics, and people, plus local news and weather every 30 minutes. Here's Craig.
I'd sacrifice anything come what might for the sake of having you near, in spite of a warning voice that comes in the night and repeats, repeats in my ear. Don't you know, little fool, you never can win.
Good morning and welcome back. Sunrise Show on KCMX, News Talk 880. And so thrilled to have with us on the phone a great American. POW of the Vietnam War, civilian. He was a military pilot for the Marine Corps. He was shot down in Korea and rescued by the USS Kidd, and then, of course, employed as a civilian pilot during the Vietnam conflict for the Department of Defense, and was taken prisoner in 1965. He was released in 1973, and he was the longest-held civilian in the Vietnam conflict, Mr. Ernie Brace. And so glad you're with us this morning. Ernie, how you doing?
I'm doing fine, Craig. Good health.
Great, great, great. Well, all of these years, so long ago, and just it was just such a pleasure to have you on the phone today. And I know that they're going to be giving you an award at Kingsley Field on Friday. And, you know, it's the least we can do. They're going to be awarding you a POW medal and two Purple Hearts. And you've come through so much. But I think out of all of that, the celebration, you know, the resilience of what you can do if you really put your mind to it. What were some of the things that you held on to when you were in captivity that allowed you to stay inside yourself? You know, how did you stay that way? I mean, what kept you going?
I've always been a positive thinker, and when I was first captured and wasn't shot up in the firefight, I felt that this is but a temporary situation and I'll be able to escape within a few days. And they started transporting me to the Dien Bien Phu area, and I did attempt escape on the trail. I attempted escape the first night and got caught trying to crawl away. And then the next week, almost 2 weeks, was spent in walking through northern Laos to the Vietnam border, to the Dien Bien Phu area, and I escaped once on the trail. That was probably my worst punishment for an attempted escape. There I lost my front teeth, had my nose broken, and my cheekbone crushed by a rifle butt. And they finally got me into North Vietnam and put me in a cage, and I looked around and I said, well, this cage can't hold me too long. So I tried it from the cage a couple times.
Gosh. Yeah, it's just amazing when you think about day in and day out, you know, in this cage. And what did they feed you?
They fed me just what the guards were eating. There wasn't really a POW camp near the Dien Bien Phu area. It was two bamboo cages. Sergeant Harnavy, the Thai Special Forces man I was captured with, was in one of the cages. He's about 100 yards from me down a jungle trail. And so I didn't see him for quite a while. And my cage was backed up against a limestone karst, and we could hear aircraft going over, and we could hear bombing off in the distance, and occasionally any aircraft fire, but it wasn't a regular POW camp. I stayed in those cages for 3.5 years, solitary, and because of escape attempts, the last 2.5 years in the cage were spent in stocks and actually an iron hoop around my neck for a while.
It's just fascinating. I mean, the story doesn't seem to end. It just seems like it goes on and on. And then, of course, I got to watch the Nat Geo special, POWs in Vietnam, and you along with John McCain, and you got to the Hanoi Hilton, and of course you communicated, and that was a low point in your life, but that he and that communicating with another American, that gave you renewed hope, didn't it?
Well, actually, the low point came in the cages, and in December of 1967.
That's right.
I attempted to commit suicide in the cage by strangling myself on the neck rope, but I woke up and I was still there. So I decided that they were keeping me alive for some reason. And then in October 68, they took me to Hanoi, and as luck would have it, I was dumped into another solitary cell, but I was right behind John McCain, who was also in solitary on the other side of the wall.
Right, and then of course in 73, I mean, the Hanoi Hilton has its own story behind it, and of course communicating with John McCain, just knowing that there were other Americans there, that had to have given you some strength.
Yes, you had to keep your mind occupied. The ones that died up there were the ones that went and sat in the corner and worried about everything. And one of the first things you do is not to worry about those things you don't have any control over. You know, what's happening to my wife, what's happening to my family, and that type of thing. You've got to get over that and concentrate on what you're doing and get active in the resistance within the camp and the communication system, which was the core of the resistance.
Exactly. You know, I saw this this poem that you wrote, Prisoner in a Cage. When did you write that?
I wrote that after I didn't have any way to write, and it was strictly memory. I did it in the cage after I tried to strangle myself on the neck rope in that December 1967, and I probably did it in the spring of 68. And thinking back on it, and whenever I write it down, I've got several little variations in some of the verses in it, but actually, the poem has existed and has been published several times, and it more or less tells the story of my captivity.
Yeah, you're no kidding. Well, I would think you probably had it memorized by that. One of the things that we talked about this was that when you got back, you continued your pursuit. You, of course, love flying. You love aviation. And tell us, when you got back, you recovered for a year, San Diego Hospital, and then you renewed again. I mean, you've traveled all over the world, Africa, China, Russia. What were your thoughts, I guess, about continuing going with the help, you know, in the U.S. aviation? What kept you going there?
I was probably one of the few that came out of Hanoi, and as we were walking out to the aircraft, had the thought, I've got to start looking for a job. So when I got out, I got picked up, and I think I had a guardian angel someplace in the government, because the assignments I got just kept taking me back into these places. And the first one was with Evergreen of Oregon, Evergreen International, and they had foreign military contracts all over the world at the time. I ended up back in Saigon, actually, in 1974, setting up an operation offshore for them. And then when Saigon fell in 75, that operation ended, and I ended up in Mexico in 76 with the DEA, with the Evergreen providing the aircraft and pilots and chemical, and we were spraying poppies and marijuana in Mexico for a couple of years. It was the start of the drug war in Mexico, and it's still going on. They still haven't done it.
Wow. Well, drugs obviously have come a long way with the Mexican cartels and the marijuana grows in Oregon and Northwest. You know, as we finish our interview today, what would you tell young people based off of, you know, love of country and the resilience and never giving up?
Well, I'd tell them, number one, believe in yourself and have faith that you're going to come out of this and you're going to come out of it alive. I've been in various situations. I was just reading about a guy who sucked an oxygen tank or a scuba tank dry down about 90 feet and panicked, and I can remember sucking one dry at about 90 feet off of Cape Hatteras when I was doing a lot of scuba diving, and I calmly came up, and I know that every 10 feet you can get another little breath out of that tank, and I took my time coming up, and he was bleeding from ears and nose and everything when he came up, and by keeping my faith in myself and not panicking, I got to the surface with no problems, and that's sort of been the story of my life. I don't remember panicking under any situation, and I've been in some pretty tight ones at different times.
Wow, yeah. Well, Ernie, thank you so much, and just all we want to say is congratulations. You're a great American, and we're honored and privileged to have you in our state, and we're privileged to have you among us, and we just wish you all the best. POW local Vietnam veteran Ernie Brace, a prisoner of war medal and two Purple Hearts will be awarded to him this coming Friday at Kingsley Field at 2:00, an official ceremony. Ernie, thank you so much. Just a privilege and an honor to have you on this morning.
Thank you very much, Craig.
All right. Take care, and we will talk to you hopefully soon. Maybe even see you on Friday.
Great.
All right.
Thank you very much.
All righty.
Bye.
Wow, ladies and gentlemen, Ernie Brace, most amazing American. We got to go for the day. We'll be back. We'll see you tomorrow. Short day tomorrow. Stay tuned for Mike Huckabee coming up next.